So, a warmest of greetings on this blessed Christmas morning. Whether you're regular worshippers here, whether you're occasional worshippers, or from further afield, I've already met several visitors from various countries, South Africa, United States, Indonesia, Ukraine, Wales. If I've missed anything out, my apologies. Anyway, you're all welcome. Take your seats. Today's service is, as usual, since the 1st of December, our locum, the Reverend Dr. Lauran Bethell. There she is, in waiting to the front. She's going to be our minister and preacher today. She's from California in the United States, and she's had a very, very hectic month, and we're looking forward to her once again on this Christmas morning. There are no printed notices on your sheet, but those who are based in the Netherlands, on the 2nd of January, early in the new year, we have a regular 10:30 Tuesday coffee morning. So you're very welcome for tea, coffee, cake, excellent conversation, and who knows, something else maybe. Right. I think without further ado, I'll hand over to Reverend Dr. Lauran Bethell. Okay.
Welcome. Can we join together in sharing the call to worship printed in your bulletins? Please join with me in the reading out loud the bold type of the call to worship. Wonder of wonders, Christ has come to us, not as a judge, but a savior, not in power, but as a servant. Wonder of wonder, God comes to us, not in silence, the word made flesh, not in shadows, but bringing light. Wonder of wonders, God is with us, Jesus is born. And now let us stand and singing together that great hymn of Christmas, Joy to the World, number 320. I'd like to invite any children who are here tonight, this morning. Would some children like to come and help me light the candles? Would you like to come and help me light the Advent candles? Please do. I have a little gift also for those who come. Would you like to come? Oh, don't I have any volunteers at all? Would you come? Thank you. I appreciate that. Yay, bold. What's your name?
Tara.
Tara. Where are you from, Tara?
The Netherlands, but my mom is from India.
Yes, of course. That's wonderful. This is a very... Would you like to... Are you being more brave now? No. Okay. Well, Tara, I appreciate you coming and joining me in lighting the Advent candles. All through this month, we have been lighting the candles. And I'll let you do that. You can light this candle from here. And the first candle we lit this month was a candle of hope. And you can light it because of the hope that we have in Jesus Christ, who we celebrate today. Excellent. And the next candle is the candle. Maybe you could go to the front. It was the candle of peace because of the peace that Jesus brings us. Thank you. And the next candle was the candle of joy, the joy that we can find in Jesus. And the very last candle was the candle we lit yesterday, the candle of love. Excellent. And this morning, for the first time, we are going to light the middle candle because we're celebrating Jesus' birth. That's the Christ candle. We don't get to light that candle until this very moment, celebrating Jesus' birth. Thank you so much, Tara, for lighting the candles for us. And and I pray that you have a wonderful, special Merry Christmas.
Thank you.
And we had some books that were written by our, are they, oh, here they are. I'm going to invite Lance. Where's Lance? And is Robin here too? Where's Lance Stone? Come here, Lance. Okay. Whoops. I understand that you wrote a book.
Oh.
And that your daughter Robin illustrated it. Is that right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Maybe you could hand these. And the other children that are here, we have some extras of these to give as little Christmas presents. Lance, what was this book about, anyway?
Well, last year was the Queen's Jubilee in the UK. And in the Bible, there is a history of the Jubilee. And I wanted to try and connect the two things, basically. So it was a story that was trying to take up the idea of Jubilee, which is why it's called Magpie Jubilee. So.
Wonderful. Maybe you could give those two to those children over there. At here, you can take and give that one, and you can have one, and meet these children here. Here's a child. You want to hand one back to her, and maybe these children could have, okay, one between them. And here's a child. Would you like to have this one? Oh, okay. You'll take it for him. Great. Thank you so much. Nothing like spontaneity in the Christmas morning worship service. We like surprises. Okay, and then let's join together in singing hymn number 282. Christmas is coming. Christmas is here. And by the end of that, that last verse celebrates the moment that Christmas has arrived, that Christ is born. Would you stand and sing with me? Hymn number 282.
Jesus.
And let us pray. Jesus, the light of the world, as we celebrate your birth, may we begin to see the world in the light of the understanding that you give us. As you chose the lowly, the outcast, and the poor to receive the greatest news of the world that the world had ever known, so may we worship you in humbleness of heart as we pray the prayer that you taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now let us sing together. Stand and sing hymn number 323, The First Noel.
Thank you.
Please be seated.
Good morning. The first reading today is taken from the book of Isaiah, chapter 52, the verses 7 to 10. And you can find this in your pew Bibles on page 693. Isaiah 52, starting at verse 7. How beautiful upon the mountains are the feet of the messenger who announces peace, who brings good news, who announces salvation, who says to Zion, your God reigns. Listen, your sentinels lift up their voices. Together they sing for joy, for in plain sight they see the return of the Lord to Zion. Break forth together in singing, you ruins of Jerusalem, for the Lord has comforted his people. He has redeemed Jerusalem. The Lord has bared his holy arm before the eyes of all the nations, and all the ends of the earth shall see the salvation of our God. Here ends the first lesson.
This morning is the Christmas story from Luke's Gospel, chapter 2, verses 1 through 20. In those days, a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth to Galilee, to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child, and she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flocks by night. And then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were terrified. But the angel said unto them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find the babe wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom he favors." And when the angels had left them and gone back into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us now go into Bethlehem and see this thing which has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste, and they found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. And when they saw this, they made known what had been told them about this child. But all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. But Mary kept all these things and treasured them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all that they had heard and seen as it had been told them. I grew up in a pastor's family in Central California. My mother was a professional pastor's wife who loved music and the arts. And for years, she produced an epic production of a live nativity scene on our church lawn. She directed church members to build the miniature city of Bethlehem, including shops and the inn and a barn where most of the action took place. A bit of a distance away was the shepherd station. And the cast of the production were members of the congregation. There were about 50 who were in the production, all costumed, elaborate costumes made up of all kinds of things that Mother picked up from secondhand stores and remade. And it was quite a production. Including in this cast of 50 were about 20 angels, fully winged, tiny children up to 20-somethings. And when I graduated from college and became a teacher, my mother appointed me the dubious honor of being head angel, which meant to try to keep all those unangelic little ones from totally destroying the place and keep them under control for the three performances we did every night and then in between our appearances. Now, my younger brother got to be a shepherd. And this was a role that the teenage boys vied for because they got to sit around a warm fire and wear tattered clothes and keep the live sheep that were there under control and from running away. Sometimes it didn't work. When the angel appeared unto them, they competed for the most dramatic shepherd award, who could act the most shocked and surprised when the angels came. And they often came close to catching their clothing on fire during their theatrics. One year, a lamb was born during the week of the performances, and they all took turns carrying the lamb to the manger, adding to the drama of it all. Now, that nativity scene was one of our most distinctive memories of our childhood and youth, and was often said to be the highlight of Christmas for both observers and participants. Those shepherds, though, in addition to acting in the performance, they also spent the night at the church, theoretically, to take care of the animals, the horse, the donkey, the sheep, and also that also start in the performance. But oh, the mayhem they created. They not only played football in the church sanctuary, nearly destroying the Christmas tree, but one time they also took the donkey for a joyride down the middle of the street, nearly getting arrested. Thankfully, the police knew my father and simply accompanied them back to the church, sternly reprimanding them, but I think also trying to stifle their laughter. Those shepherds. In order to fully grasp the meaning of this day, God's coming to earth, live, to live among us as a human being, born as a baby, we have to understand who God chose to participate in this most amazing event. Those of you who are Dutch understand the importance of the birth announcements. Lovely cards, sometimes poetic, often very artistic, planned way in advance, sent out almost immediately after the arrival of the child. God also had a plan for the announcement of Jesus' birth. Now, you might think the Almighty God would let royalty and the elite of society and temple, those who had the capacity to spread the news far and wide, know first about God in the flesh being born. But no. The birth announcement that God gives out goes to a group of anonymous sheepherders on the outskirts of Bethlehem. Sheepherders. Now, the shepherds are forever immortalized in our Christmas hymns and nativity scenes, and we picture them with crooked canes and flowing robes as if they actually belonged at the birthplace of a king. But the reality is they didn't belong there at all. In fact, they didn't belong anywhere. To see the Christmas time through their eyes, we have to understand their situation. There were few occupations more demanding or more degrading than a shepherd. They were the last people you'd expect God to take notice of. First of all, they were religious outcasts. According to religious law, these men were unclean. Because their work was a 7-day-a-week job, it prevented them from participating in the feasts and holy days that made up the Jewish religious calendar. Why? Well, somebody had to watch the sheep. When everyone else was making the trip to Jerusalem to make sacrifices at the temple, they were out in the fields watching over the sheep. And a modern-day example may be a truck driver, a shift worker whose job keeps them from regularly attending church. It wasn't really their fault, but they were excluded. They weren't regular attenders, so they didn't belong. Not only were they religious outcasts, but shepherds were social outcasts as well. Since they were constantly on the move to find new pastures for their flocks, they were looked on with suspicion as untrustworthy nomads. They were often accused of being thieves. If something came up missing, it must have been those shepherds. They were not permitted to give testimony in a legal proceeding because their word was not considered trustworthy. And on top of all that, they didn't have much contact with other people. Most of the time, they were living out in the fields. This was not a job with regular hours. They didn't come home every night for dinner. They were with the sheep 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And during the day, they had to lead the sheep to grass and water, and they watched while the sheep grazed, and they kept an eye out for predators. And at night, they actually slept in the field to guard against theft and animal attack. They didn't exactly smell so great either. By profession and social status, they were loners. So why the shepherds? Why do you see why the shepherds might not have belonged at the crib side of the birth of the newborn king, the Messiah? Now, step back for a moment. Imagine you're God and you want to announce the most amazing, incredible, joyous news, an event that will literally change the course of history, the birth of your only son, Jesus Christ. The birth of your only son, Jesus Christ, who will be the savior of the whole world, the one for whom the nation of Israel has been waiting and hoping and praying for thousands of years. Finally, he has come. Who gets the announcement? Who makes the cut? Who do you think to invite to come and see? Not Caesar, not Herod, not the Pharisees, the shepherds, smelly, dirty, socially and religiously excluded sheepherders. Now, can you imagine how the conductor of the angel choir must have felt when she realized her audience wasn't the royal family? It's as if they'd rehearsed all year long to perform a great work of music and ended up giving the concert for the cleaning crew of the concert hall. Why go to them? Were they outstanding believers in God? No, nothing shows us that. Had this visitation been a prophecy in the Old Testament? Nope, not that we have record of. The shepherds were probably convinced that God had no idea who they were. They didn't go to the temple, hardly read the Hebrew scriptures. Did God even know who they are? The shepherds would ask. Everyone in the local synagogue had told them they weren't welcome. They didn't belong. That God didn't care about their smelly existence. Is it any wonder then that when the angel of the Lord appears to them, they were absolutely terrified? Why would they hear the angel's announcement? And the angel said, "Don't be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy. Not bad news, not condemnation. Today in the town of David," yes, David the shepherd, just like them, "in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you." You mean to us? Does she really mean that God has given something to us? The shepherds must have been thinking. "He is Christ the Lord," she announces to them. And the shepherds, who are normally obsessive in their protection of the flock, who live to watch over the animals, they leave the sheep behind and race off to see the baby. And after they do, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child. They become live birth announcements. And I love how people responded to this. The Bible said all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. I bet they were. This is not the kind of information which a shepherd is usually privy to. It seems the shepherds were a strange choice. But I think that God knew, I know that God knew what God was doing here. If God had gone to Caesar or Herod or anyone else in power, they would have tried to turn this miraculous event to their advantage. How can we use this to increase our prestige and power? People in power are always looking for ways to increase their power. Or they would have been threatened, as Herod was, in ordering the baby boys to be killed. The shepherds, they have absolutely nothing to gain, and they have absolutely nothing to lose. They were empty vessels, totally empty vessels, waiting to be filled to overflowing with God's joy. They were proof that God's message is for everyone, from the highest to the lowest, from the most faithful churchgoer to the seeker, to the skeptic. God's word is for everyone. With God, everyone is important. In the 80s and 90s, I ran a shelter in Thailand for teenage girls who were at risk for or had been exploited and abused. And they were from the hill tribe communities, from the jungles of northern Thailand and Burma. They were unsophisticated. They were very, very poor. They were illiterate. But oh, could they sing. Perfect pitch, multi-part harmonies, naturally. Now, I became friends with the U.S. Consul General in the city where we were living, and he invited us to come to his palatial residence to sing Christmas carols for his holiday party, which invited the most prestigious people in the community, plus the consul employees. The girls sang angelically. And many of the consulate employees were moved to tears with their listening to the carols. They sang familiar carols in their own languages, fully believing the message of the birth of the Christ child. And after their little outdoor concert, the consul general invited them into his residence to eat from the tables of delicious finger foods and to mingle with the guests. These girls, uneducated, in their mismatched, well-worn clothes, mixing with extremely highly educated, wealthy people wearing fashionable dresses and suits and being hosted with kindness and a kind of admiration. Those listening had been emotionally moved by the heartfelt music with the words of comfort and joy. And as I watched, I felt I was witnessing a moment that God had orchestrated. These girls from backgrounds of poverty and exploitation banqueting with those representing power and wealth. It was the kingdom of God, inclusive of all, the lowly bringing the Christmas story of love, softening actually the hearts and minds of the wealthy and powerful. The angels, literally the most heavenly choir ever, was dispatched by God to announce the birth of God's Son, God in the flesh, to the lowliest of the low, the most heavenly of creatures, God's reverse kingdom. God wanted the most humble to know and witness first of his birth of his Son. God wants us to come as we are, whether it's in tatters or designer clothes, whether we live in expensive houses or middle-class houses or on the streets, whether we have doubts or fears, whether we can sing like the angels or barely carry a tune, whether we are gay or straight or whether we live are somewhere on the spectrum or not, we are invited to come as we are, and gaze in wonder and awe at the Christ child, and let the light and the power of God's love pierce through our hearts and enter our minds. God with us is born today. Hallelujah. Let us pray. On this, your birthday, dear Jesus, may we celebrate you and celebrate you with joy, celebrate you with thanksgiving. May our lives be so full of the light of your love that your hope and joy are evident everywhere we go, in everything we do. In your holy name, amen.
So before I offer actually the prayers of intercession, one important announcement. It states on your order of service, please join us for refreshments after the service. Unfortunately, there will be no refreshments today. So you can, by all means, converse after the service amongst others, amongst yourselves. So let us pray. Prince of Peace, on this glorious day of celebration, we pray for peace in our troubled world, remembering in particular the people of Israel, Gaza, Ukraine, and the traumatized students of Charles University in Prague. Inspire us to work towards reconciliation and harmony among all people. Bless us with your presence and guide us in your ways. Bless those in need. And may the message of God coming to this earth to bring light into darkness be central to our lives. May we shine in the dark places. We pray for all those who are alone or feeling isolated on this Christmas day. May they find comfort in the company of friends and family and in the warmth of your love, Lord. We ask for your blessing upon families gathered together today, that they may cherish the moment of togetherness and strengthen their bonds of love. We pray for families that are separated this time of year. Lord, bring your comfort. We pray for those less fortunate that they may experience the generosity and kindness of others during this season of giving. We remember those who are ill or suffering. May they find healing and solace in your loving presence, especially during this season. And in a moment of silence now, we bring before you our own prayers for those we love, for those in need. Lord, may you receive our prayers. Lord, hear our prayers. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We now give you the opportunity to share your resources in giving to the ministries of this church as it is serving those here in our community and also around the world. And we thank you for your generosity. Would the ushers please come forward to receive the offering at this time? Pray. We ask, dear Lord, that you bless these gifts and use them in service to those you love. And in your name we pray. Amen. Amen. Let's put them up. Now let us join in our final hymn, number 322, Good Christians All Rejoice.
Thank you.
beside you on this day and show you God's love, God's peace, and God's joy now and forevermore. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.